My name is Peter Meissen. This is our final in the series for the GeoDesign series that we've been doing all summer with students from around the world. It's called GeoDesign, Engineering the Transition to Clean Energy and Clean Water for All. We've had them from students from up and down California, Chicago, and a half a dozen from Brazil. So about half of them are left. Some of them had to go back to university already. So the six that you see here are those that are going to complete. And I'm thrilled because this is the culmination of this whole series. So you're going to get the best of everything they learned and their recommendations. We call it the roadmap. So, you know, what would you do if you could be the energy czar, the water czar? What would you recommend for San Diego, Northern Baja, two totally different regions, as what would you do for the country of Brazil? So we focused on that country as well. So I'm real proud of the work that they've done here all summer. It's been an 11-week series. They don't have it up there anymore, but this was the invitation that I think you all saw online, and they went through a whole process where 1 through 5 looked at really asking the question, who we are and where do we live, sort of a demographic understanding, and then the question, what is geodesign at the first place, how do we actually ask the questions, what are the problems and what are the ideal states? So they looked at that in the second in the series. Third in the series was really all about mapping, and Anna was very involved in that. How do you develop layered maps to really understand not only who we are and where we live, but the resource potential for energy and water? Last session was on best practices. So what are all the solutions? All of the solutions, not necessarily the recommended ones. So that was what they covered this last time. And then tonight is all about their recommendations for the state that we're in today, for Southern California, Northern Baja, and for Brazil. So they've done some brilliant work. These are mostly environmental engineers in their training from universities, and I will let them introduce themselves again. So I'm really proud to work with them all. They've done great work, learned a lot, and this was their part of their course catalog was this book called GeoDesign. It came from ESRI. They are the leading mapping supplier, and if you'd like to get a copy tonight, throw a contribution in the jar. This is a great study of some of the best examples of how do you do this work within different cities around the world. So we have some extra copies of those if you wanted to get those as well. Want to welcome our viewers from around the world online. They'll be able to watch this after we're done. Anything else to introduce? Paul Michael, did I leave anything out? No, we good? All right, great. And we'll have a little wrap up at the end. So this will have Clay Meyer and Derek Frommel. They'll be doing the first presentation this evening. And this is on really how the roadmap for sustainable Southern California and Northern Baja. And who's getting started is Clay. Clay, come on up. Introduce yourself.
Hi, everyone. Thank you guys for coming. My name is Clay Meyer. And Derek and I are going to be presenting the fifth and final presentation of the GeoDesign series, which is the roadmap to a sustainable San Diego and Northern Baja. Can we didn't switch the slides yet.
What you have to do if you're sitting at these numbers is you have to click to the number that you see in the bottom of the screen that corresponds to the computer that you're at. So on this one, you're sitting at number 6. Click number 6
All right, so in previous presentations, we covered the current state of energy and water in the two areas of Northern Baja and San Diego. And in summary, we found that as our consumption is increasing and the demand for water and fresh water and energy is increasing, the supply of fresh water is decreasing, and our supply of energy is still largely reliant on fossil fuels. So tonight what we're going to be talking about is how we get from our current state to our preferred state, which is the roadmap. And our preferred state is one in which San Diego and Northern Baja are largely reliant on renewable energy and consume water sustainably. So First, I'm going to talk about the large-scale solutions for our regions, and then I'm going to get into small-scale solutions and residential solutions, and then Derek's going to do the same for water. So to start us off, one of the most prevalent sources of energy in our regions is wind power, and many companies have already started to take advantage of that. For example, the Canon Power Group and Gamera Technology Corporation have planned the Abenel Wind Project, which is going to take place in northern Baja, near the border, near a town called La Hermosa. So, moving on here to the next slide, you can see that there's a ton of potential along the mountain ranges in northern Baja, and you can see that where the Abenel Wind Project is planned is right in these red and blue areas, which have the greatest potential, and these projects take advantage of the greatest potential for wind power in northern Baja. So we suggest, as Jeannie, that we continue to take advantage of this potential and that we expand the current wind farms or that we implement new wind farms in these areas. So now moving on to Sierra California mountain range. So we think it's important to implement wind farms in these areas because there's also great potential along the Sierra California mountain range, and we think that wind farms should be implemented in places where there's not a great tourist attraction and there's little development planned. So moving on here, so that was a brief segment on wind, and now we're going to get into solar. So the largest potential for power in our areas is solar power, and California has done a pretty good job of taking advantage of this, and in for the 8th consecutive year, California has led the way in new solar power innovation and has had a twofold increase in large-scale installments compared to 2012. And our largest area for solar potential is actually in the east portion of Southern California, in the desert regions. And there are plants already installed, such as Evenpah Solar Thermal Station. But there's enough potential in this area alone to produce energy for all of Southern California and Northern Baja. So similar to the wind power plants, we suggest that these current plants are either expanded or that new plants are put in these same areas where there's a ton of potential. Moving on to the next one, here's another great example of a project that was a success, and this was put in place last February, this past February, and it's a solar plant that extends from Riverside County all the way up to Joshua Tree and provides enough energy for 160,000 homes. But we want to make the point that it's imperative that we act now because we act now as some of these companies have, like BrightSource and NextEra Energy, because some of these incentives that I'll talk about later are not going to be around forever. And you'll see that later. But yeah, just mainly it's very important to act now. So getting into some of these policies, one example of this is the 30% cost reduction that's for both residential and commercial solar installations that the federal government put in place. Additionally, the Obama administration recently reserved some 22 million acres in California alone for renewable projects, primarily solar. So I'll take questions here, but the next slide directly relates to this. But yeah, I guess are there any questions so far?
This is the time. So we're just going to focus on these 12. Don't jump ahead because they got more recommendations for sure. Anything on these 12? This is what these guys are suggesting. So, or more than a suggestion, actually recommending to either expand or continue with what's working. So that's the whole focus for this evening. We all good so far? Okay, good. So let's change the next slide set all the way around so we can see 13 on the first one all the way around to 24. So those of you know, so this one.
All right, great. So, pointing to this first slide, we're gonna be talking about one of these policies that was put in place but didn't last forever. So, California's Energy Emerging Renewables Program that was put in place in 1997 was a great policy that got the ball rolling in California for renewable energy. But as renewable energies became more established, this policy was rolled back and it was taken out of place in 2012. So this makes the point that some of these policies, well, it's not up anymore, but the 30% cost reduction that is in place because of the federal government, they're not going to be around forever. And it's important that these companies take action very soon. And this will also relate to the small scale, and which I'll talk about in a little bit. Got a duplication here. Oh, there we go. All right, cool. So relating to policies, what we recommend is that this 30%, for example, this 30% cost reduction, these kind of policies make sure that these stay around for as long as possible and that we can, as long as the funding is still there. But also that in Northern Bajas, it would be great if a policy like the 1997 policy, the Emerging Renewable Program, could take place there, and that would help get the ball rolling in Northern Baja for a start. So the last point I want to make about large-scale energy is that it's very imperative that the two regions that I'm talking about work together and cooperate. So you can see here on slide 16, there's three black suns you can kind of see there, and those are three solar plants that are installed now, and they provide energy for both the northern region of Baja and for Southern California. Why in the future we might want to build more plants is because the lack of policy there might expedite the construction of plants, and we can build these plants when policies are still in place, and it'll benefit both regions. When you look past this past year, last past years, cooperation, international cooperation with countries such as Spain, South Korea, and Israel have led to some of the biggest achievements in renewable energy recently. All right, so I'm going to get into small-scale solutions now. Just flip over here again. So I'm going to start with rooftop solar. And on this slide, you can see stats that prove why rooftop solar is both more economically feasible. So if you see here, there's about a household, an average household of a three-person household uses around 6,000 kilowatt hours of energy per year. But due to the fact that we live in one of the areas that has the greatest potential for solar energy in the country, just a 5-kilowatt system on a roof, which is a pretty common capacity, would produce way above this. It would almost produce double, given that there are 5.7 peak equivalent hours per day. And many homes have turned to just installing capacities of 3 kilowatts or 4, like Peter just installed a 4-kilowatt capacity system on his roof. So that's one point. Also, you see here that it says $20,000 upfront cost for, that's about an average cost for a 5-kilowatt system. And that might seem like a lot, but with incentives that are in place today, this cost will be cut in almost a half. So it may seem expensive at first, but when you get into it, it actually is a lot less expensive, and the payback is just in about 6 to 8 years. It can even be less for smaller systems. And this payback doesn't include the increased value of a home that has rooftop solar on it. So maybe a way to spark the installation of these rooftop solar systems is to educate the public. And I feel like a lot of homeowners have heard about it, but really what they think is it's kind of an expensive option, and it's probably in that it's not a good option for them. But we believe that it's the responsibility of partly the government, partly the utilities, but and largely the solar companies to inform the public of the great economic benefits in the long run, as you can see in these in this graph to the right, and the importance to act soon and to get these systems up. And that's partly why a lot of people have been putting them up recently. So now going into solutions, some for Northern Baja on slide 22. There, one of the solutions we propose is a solar water heater. So that may sound expensive at first, but and the system on the left here may look a little bit complicated, but really all it is just a tank, a reflective surface, and some glass to keep the heat in, and the piping. So this system is around $300 to $400, but you can even get a cheaper system, which is just a dark-colored roof-mounted tank that's gravity-fed, and that's easily self-installed, which will reduce some of the costs for installation as well. Additionally, this is back to San Diego, but there's a ton, that's an, you can't see it, but that's an LED bulb. There's a ton of household appliances that are also greatly incentivized. And for example, LED bulbs, just for a 6-watt bulb, you can get up to a $6 rebate on that purchase. So and that and this list is just an example. This box is just an example. There's just lists of commercial incentives and other residential ones. And finally, there are a ton of easy household, just simple household fixes that everyone can do that save a ton on your energy, reduce your energy consumption, and in turn reduce your energy bill. For example, upgrading your insulation in a household, especially old households, can save up to 50% on your cooling and heating bill. And the list below is another just kind of easy installing shutters, getting a smart thermostat, easy fixes that may conserve a ton of energy in the long run. So, thank you.
Very nice. So,
So questions about this set of 12. Some of them, we sort of start with policies at the state level, and then we moved into things that you could do both on both sides of the border, and then finally what you can do in your homes, not only on the conservation side, but just simple systems on the rooftop. So Paul Michael, let me get over here.
Are there any simple solutions for getting rid of some of the phantom loads, all those little red dots that we see on all the appliances? Is there an easy way to do that?
I would say if they're not in use, you can unplug them. That's what I do at my house. I don't know exactly what you mean by phantom loads, but that's what I would say.
Phantom loads or vampire loads are all of those little green lights that are throughout our houses that are ready to turn on immediately when you turn on an appliance. And they apparently, if you totaled all them up, there's hundreds of power plants that are required to meet that phantom load, that vampire load. Aren't there power strips that you can use now, Paul Michael, to actually turn off the whole power strip and that's the way to handle it?
Yeah, so.
One way.
I guess, yeah, we use, in my house at least, we use power strips, and also just unplugging an appliance like toaster or something like that after you're done using it also can save energy.
Alex had a question.
Thank you very much for your good presentation so far. I would encourage you to emphasize, for example, in slide 19, just behind you, when you say San Diego has an average of 5.7 peak equivalent hours per day, I don't think most of our watchers or participants understand what you mean by that.
Okay.
This is an incredible solar resource, worldwide speaking, what San Diego has, 5.7 kilowatt hour at 1,000 watt, 5.7 hours at 1,000 watt per day. This is outstanding. I would highlight that, because then San Diegans really understand and can be a good example. If you highlight that as well on slide 22, I think it's very important, instead of saying $300 to $400, I mean, what do you mean in regard to temperature, in regard to size? What services do people get for that?
Right.
People like to have hot water. They like to have like 5 showers, 10 minutes a day on hot water. That's what people understand.
Right.
Bring it in units and in terms like that. You're right. There's nothing wrong. You're absolutely right. And I'm personally excited. Bring it in terms so that our watchers can understand it.
Yeah,
we do, but 90% of the people don't, the units, right?
Yeah. Well, this slide 22 is more specifically a solution for Northern Baja. So, like you said, this is going to be a new source of hot water that they'll it's a luxury that many of the people that will have this have never had before. And especially with the simpler system, it'll provide a easy access to hot water, which is a thing that a lot of households down there don't have. So, yeah, but good point.
Here you go, Norm.
Did you look at the problem of a vested San Diego Gas and Electric Company who really see this as a competitive technology and would rather not see it around, and they are basically in control? Did you wrestle with that problem at all?
I know personally in Arizona, the companies like that are the ones with the most money and have the best lobbyists and stuff. So to change the policies, it's very hard. And in Arizona, at least, we had some of these incentives in place, but due to lobbying from companies that are founded on fossil fuel energy production, a lot of them have been taken out of place, which has kind of set us back. But that's an example of that, but not directly relating to California or San Diego region. No.
So tell me, I believe SDG&E doesn't lose any money when I put solar on my rooftop, because they don't make any money on the electrical portion of that anymore, if I understand it correctly. So they didn't lose any income, because they would have purchased that power and it had been a pass-through anyway. So they don't have a loss in that equation. They're still getting transmission and distribution fees from me, which is where they're making their money now. They're making their money on that support infrastructure, not on providing kilowatt hours.
Isn't the problem their perception of it as invading their market? And actually, they want to do. Why should we support solar? It should be able to stand on its own 2 feet and pay for itself.
And I know that the utilities in California have some fees that they want to, sort of like a standard connection fee, right, or a monthly fee that they want to incur. Because I'm still getting the benefit of the grid, because I'm pushing power back onto the grid, but I'm no longer paying for that last bit of that connection. So that's their argument. There's arguments on the other side as well. So that's in what the PUC discussion right now in California. I don't know how that'll turn out. Other states will be different, right? Other states will be different than California. But we clearly are a leader in San Diego. We have more rooftop installations than I think either absolute or percentage than any other place in the country. And we have a leading utility because we're at 33% for renewables today, ahead of the time by 5 years before we had to meet that. So as much as I think you sometimes get pushed back from the local utility, they're meeting those targets and exceeding them as well on their own mandates for that renewable portfolio standard. They didn't get in the way of putting solar on my roof. They didn't have a choice.
They are in the way of putting solar on condominium units, because they say each individual condominium owner has to assent to it.
Right.
And to get 100% of anybody to say yes is very difficult.
You'll never get 100% of anything, right, in this country. Okay, great. Other questions about this set of 12? We good? Are we going to move to Derek now? All right, great. So next student here will be Derek Frommel. Am I going to say that last name correctly?
How do you say it?
How do I say it? Frommel?
Frommel.
Thank you. Thank you. So if you'd start flipping your slides to now 25 through 36 all the way around the room, I think you guys know how to do that. And as soon as they start coming up, introduce yourself a little bit of your background, Derek, so they don't not
so, only. I come from the city of Chicago. My undergrad's in environmental science from Lewis University. It's kind of in the suburbs out there. And for my graduate degree, me and Anand both went to Southern Illinois University in Carbondale, where we studied advanced energy and fuels. So, yeah, that's pretty much in a nutshell my history. We got the slides up almost. Yeah, so today we're going to talk about water now, and here at Genie, we've kind of broken it down into large scale and small scale, and specifically under large scale, we went for desalination, wastewater recycling, and new innovations. So to kind of kick it off, we're going to talk about desalination. Here, let me get the laser pointer. It's not here, never mind. Oh, here it is. So over on this slide right here, we can see that this is California. Here's Southern California and kind of up the coastline. You can see Monterey Bay. And the thing to kind of take away from this map right here is that there's existing power desal plants, and then there's proposed and planned desal plants. A lot of them in Southern California, especially in Southern California, there's a lot of proposed. And here's a map of Israel. Now, the reason this is important is because the Middle East has proven that desalination can work on a large scale, and they've become extremely efficient at it. As you can see up the side of the bank here, that Israel uses 4 desalination plants to produce a lot of their fresh water, and they're actually increasing that still today. And this is kind of important also because we share very similar climates with the Middle East, and Israel actually, their reverse osmosis technology are what we're currently using in the Carlsbad plant, what's going to be constructed soon. I think it's going to be finishing within the year. And basically, if the Carlsbad plant demonstrates to be extremely effective and feasible, it's probably going to cause a large chain reaction where we're going to see more and more desal plants up the coast pretty soon, because it is, again, a best practice in our eyes. And again, we'll see from Carlsbad. So kind of switching over here just to demonstrate Israel's success again with the desalination technology. It's currently above 50% of its fresh water is coming from desalination, with plans to raise that to 70% by 2050. Which really isn't that large of a stretch considering they're building an even bigger plant than the Sorek plant, which is their largest right now, within the near future. And they're also talking about increasing the capacity of the current ones as well. So they have this technology down pretty well packed. So it's a good thing that we're working with them because they're pretty much the leader when it comes to reverse osmosis. So kind of changing gears now, we're going to talk a little bit about desalination costs. Specifically, as you can see here, it's come a long way since 1972. It's gone down by about $6 per 1,000 gallons. And kind of the takeaway from this that is really important is that from 1972 to 1982, we see a huge gap when it comes to price. And that's because we used to use thermal evaporation to kind of use desal, but we switched by 1982 to saltwater reverse osmosis. And since then, we've only improved in our technology. However, it's important to note that in 2002 to 2010, it's kind of stagnated. And generally, it's stagnated, we kind of see it as a bad thing. But really, what this comes down to is it's a mature technology. It's come a long way, and we've kind of got it down packed. It's well established. And this is important to note because, again, we're going to be using it probably for a long time, as long as this drought lasts, at least, and possibly even into the future. So it's pretty solid at this point. The only thing that could help it along the way is if we integrated renewable energy into electricity generation to power desalination facilities. So switching gears now, we're going to talk a little bit about recycled water, which again was the second pivotal practice that we are talking about. And generally, recycled water, it's something that hasn't been seen too much yet, but again, is gaining traction. And this is because a lot of people think of recycled water thinking, oh, it's dirty, but it's a common misconception. Recycled water actually exceeds potable water standards, and it's a multi-stage process that's extremely thorough. And the next slide over kind of demonstrates this. As you can see, it can be used for several different things, but one of those things is irrigation and industrial use, and you can actually cut it off after the first step. So there's no point in going through the multi-stage process if you want to just use it for irrigation. It actually loses a lot of the vital nutrients that can be used for that. Another thing that it could be used for is you could store it in the reservoir. I mean, currently we wouldn't be doing that, but it is an option, and we'd be able to avoid using the third step, again, save energy. But if you wanted to get it back to tap, you could go through every single one of these stages. It's completely safe and definitely something that we consider to be a best practice and something that California will definitely be using in the near future. So kind of going along that vein, San Diego has invested a lot of money specifically in this practice. They've invested about $3.5 billion in a 20-year plan with Pure Water to basically make it so that over one-third, or at least up to one-third, of the city's daily water needs are met by water recycling, wastewater recycling. And this saves money on wastewater treatment and water transportation, and it goes without saying that this is also environmentally friendly. But another thing to kind of take away from this is they want to invest $2 billion to upgrade the Point Loma wastewater facility. And again, something that could be potentially done here is that can be reinvested into, let's say, you know, Pure Water and water recycling, kind of diversify California's water portfolio. And it's definitely something that should be considered instead of, you know, Point Loma is already a pretty efficient facility. And again, diversification is never really a bad thing when it comes to this sort of thing, especially with the drought the way it is. So finally, when it comes to this, we want to talk about costs between the recycling and the desalination. And as you can see here, these really say the same thing if you do the conversions, but I thought it would be good to have it kind of in a graphical format and then just a straightforward format. As you can see here, the best practice between the two, economically speaking, would be recycling water. However, desalination is also a practice that definitely could work in conjunction with the others. It is also important to note, we didn't put it up here because we've went over it in other sessions, but wastewater recycling is actually much more energy efficient as well. Desalination takes a lot of energy right now, but again, is a pretty good practice. So finally, we get to new innovations, and I'm sure a lot of people is kind of vague, wondering what exactly that is. Well, basically, as I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, had noticed, these about two and a half weeks ago, people started dumping these black orbs, plastic black orbs, into the LA reservoirs, and basically, this is because, as you can see from this graphic, a lot of water, especially in these open sources, is lost to evaporation. And these black orbs have boasted to stop 90% of that. So basically, these are basically made so that we stop losing water at such a high rate. And this is going to be important also for Baja as well as Southern California, because again, we share a very similar climate, and they more than us are having issues when it comes to losing water. And finally, kind of the final point to take away from this is, initially, what they were planning to do was use a giant tarp, which would have cost a ton of money, and it went from a $300 million plan down to a $34.5 million plan. So it was extremely cost-effective, and again, it's a new technology, but basically, it's so far worked exactly how they had planned it. So finally, to cap that off, when it comes to the large water, it's kind of integration into Northern Baja. And what we were thinking would be an excellent practice, as you can see here, here's kind of like where the water would be, is to put rainwater capture pits with impermeable bottoms. They can use different techniques to do that around these areas, and then use the black orbs to stop, once it rains, to stop the evaporation from happening, because it would go away very quickly. And this not only would allow them to get an easy source of water when it does rain, but also, as you guys saw about a month ago when the rains happened in San Diego, it was pretty devastating, and that's no different for Northern Baja. It would cut back on the amount of water that starts flooding in those areas as well. So it's kind of killing two birds with one stone. But at this point, we kind of want to take questions on any of this.
Okay, so these were the big scale solutions that they're recommending: desalinization, recycling, the Pure Water as an example, and sort of a low-tech way, if you will,
cost-effective,
to save a whole bunch of money from evaporation. Yes?
Why black orbs instead of white orbs?
That is an excellent question. That's something that we've pondered. And again, it's a very new technique. And again, it's something that apparently they just thought was a better idea. We never actually looked into why that is. Apparently black orbs are just better than white orbs in this case.
They did have a second function, didn't they?
They do stop. They can stop carcinogens and stuff. They definitely have other benefits to them. Again, they've yet to prove exactly if those are actually happening, though. The only thing that we do know for a fact is that 90% of the evaporation, it is working on its base level, what they were meant to be used for.
Interesting question, though.
White
or black make a difference?
Because you naturally would think that black would be, it would absorb more heat, and you know the albedo effect, it would reflect more. But apparently, black was actually the way to go on this. Yeah.
Speak to that.
You want to grab the camera?
Go ahead.
Right. Well, the black orbs do absorb more heat, and the white ones do have an albedo effect. When you have white orbs, they reflect most of that UV radiation.
Mm-hmm.
So black is the superior choice, just because it absorbs more. I don't know. And to speak to the other effect, it actually blocks the UV radiation from combining with the chlorine and bromide in the water,
right,
which create carcinogens. So it's slightly, it has a slight anti-carcinogen effect.
Good. Thank you. You have a question? Yes.
Can you say something about the cost of desalization versus recycled, and then the two of them towards the conventional sources, groundwater, Colorado River, and so forth.
Just back up here. Just slide number nine.
Slide number nine, you just kind of want me to go over?
Yeah, go over that a little bit more clearly on that.
Okay, so again, we broke down the numbers on per acre foot of how much this would cost, and currently, of course, like Metropolitan Waters District, that's clearly the best option, but as water becomes more scarce, we have to look to new technologies. Recycling water is definitely more cost-effective, but desalination is also a technique that we think would be usable in the near future.
I know it's hard to see up there, but on that graph on the right,
there's
a little sliver. It says water importation, and what's the number there? Is it 0.71? Cost per cubic meter. It says water importation. What does that say up there? So 71 cents per cubic meter, and that's a fixed price. So there's no variation in that. So that's the water coming in from Metropolitan Water District as their water agency. So that's if you want to do recycling and desal, it costs more, but there's a range there.
Yeah,
and there are groundwater can be a little less, surface water can be a little less, but the idea is to, I think, spread and diversify our options,
water,
right?
Portfolio, yeah.
But right now it looks like it's about twice as expensive. Am I reading that right?
Yes.
Oh yeah, yeah, it is.
Yeah. So these two options that are I'll call high tech options are definitely more expensive because you're using more energy, more technology to recycle and pull water out of the ocean. They're more expensive.
But we're expecting these prices to go down, presumably.
Well. Just generally, this is just a fact of technology. As technology improves, yeah, the price will go down. But as you saw in the other slide, desalination has kind of hit a point where it's pretty effective the way it is. So maybe, but probably not significantly. It's kind of the harsh realities of the drought that we're in. And again, when we get to small practice, you'll see that there's actually some other techniques on a small scale that could definitely help out in terms of prices.
Other questions on these big scale solutions here? Ray.
On the desal, they're making the water near the ocean, which usually is your low point.
Yeah.
So what do they pump it? Do they pump it to the aquifer and let it flow down the piping system, or do they have different ideas about that?
Well, currently what they do with desal, and again, this is kind of a controversial issue, is what they'll do is they'll take the water in, it'll go through a multi-stage process. We actually spoke of this in detail in session 4, and they basically take the brine out and they'll just put it right back into the ocean.
But then the water that they do purify.
Oh, the purified water. Yeah, they'll send it out immediately. That's pure.
To where? To where again? Aren't they sending it to the? They're not putting it in the aquifer like Orange County. They're putting in the reservoir.
No, they can oftentimes store it. They'll keep it in storage facilities, or they can send it straight to straight to the tap if they really wanted to. But oftentimes they usually keep it in storage facilities, and they oftentimes also will add something to it to give it a certain taste. And just other benefits that normal water would have, like drinking water.
I don't think we're doing much direct potable reuse.
Yeah, no,
it's almost
definitely
a little bit of a state.
The
indirect potable reuse is what we're sort of comfortable with still.
Yeah.
We'll probably go to direct pretty quick, I think.
Maybe. I mean, yeah.
It takes a comfort factor after you get it, for a couple, 3 years. It's cultural, isn't it? Yeah. Other questions on these big scale solutions? Big expensive solutions, but when you're out of water, you willing to pay a little bit more? I guess that's the question, or should we? Okay, good. So let's. I'm sorry.
Did you look at this in terms of a watershed and keeping water within the watershed, so that if you think of a watershed as a bucket,
mm-hmm.
And it rains and fills up the bucket. But if there's a hole in the bucket, you lose the water.
Well, so naturally water will percolate back into the natural watershed, like in the system.
That's correct.
Yeah.
You mentioned up here on the
Oh, with Baja?
Well, that's the concept, right?
Yeah, yeah. And basically, that's the only reason we put that map up there is because that's where we would be using the impermeable water capture pits. Like just that was just to give a general concept of where the rainfall would be and where we would most likely want to set up the pits.
I'm talking about in the recycling system.
Recycling water?
If you did not discharge the water into the ocean, why couldn't you recycle that and keep it in the watershed?
So you're basically saying that you'd take the water from the ocean, you'd use reverse osmosis, you'd get the water and then recycle it? I'm not sure I'm, like, what he's asking.
No, you guys are talking about two different things.
Yeah, sorry, I think there's a disconnect.
I'm suggesting that the watershed is a bucket.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And as it rains, the watershed fills up with water.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not doing it.
On the other hand, if it's a leak in the bucket,
yeah,
the water drains out. And so what we've been doing is draining our watersheds and bringing in more water, but we have a leak in the bucket, and that's called the sewer system. For instance, I understand the figure, which I've not corroborated. We discharge 6 billion gallons of water a day into the Pacific, all of which are capable of being recycled. In San Diego, it's according to who you look at, it's from 150 million gallons a day to 185 million gallons a day, none of which is harvested. It's just discharged. So we use it once and throw it away.
Yeah. It's definitely something to look into.
Pure water is about that example, right? Pure water is about recycling. That's exactly what they want to do with that system, is recycle one-third of the water so it doesn't go in the ocean. They're doing it. I mean, they're doing it now, and it's at a test case, not one that's at full scale. If it went to full scale, it would meet a third of San Diego's needs.
In the cost arena, they're putting that water through three different systems, any one of which would handle going from
gray water
to clean. And the other idea is, someplace it's up here, is that we really don't need much potable water. We don't need potable water for showers, flushing toilets, and all those kinds of things that we use it for. And so you made a point someplace that in this process up here, at some point, you can cut off the process of cleaning the water.
Absolutely.
To tertiary level, and then look to water vapor for your potable water. And there are systems out there for $2,000. You can get 3 to 5 gallons a day, which is enough to support most families. A gallon of water per person per day, more than enough.
Are those the fog sheets you're talking about?
No, these are actually water generating machines. And you go online and they're there.
Kind of like a small scale solution.
Small scale.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But the whole is still consists of the sum of its parts. And if everybody did it, it would
go
away.
True, yeah. And we're going to actually talk about that just now, a small scale.
So small scale is next. We good for now? All right, good. So we flip to the last. You have one more set or two?
One more set.
Okay, so now we should see up here 37 on number one, going all the way around to 48 at the end. So 37, 38. So you're now adding 36 to your number. So these should be 42.
Just add 12.
Is that right? 36 plus 6. Yeah, 42 and 43, I think. So 37, 38, 39, 40, 41. Okay, go ahead, Derek. I think you're good.
Okay, so if we turn your attention to slide 37, I know this diagram looks a little confusing, but basically we cut this down to short-term and long-term options. The line is the median cost per acre foot, and basically what we want to take away from this is the bar shows your water savings, and basically you can tell that both in terms of cost and water savings, the urban water use efficiency is the best practice when it comes to the short-term. And when you look at long-term, it's similarly, the price goes up and the bar stays... the red one stays as the most efficient. Recycled municipal water is definitely most cost effective and the best in terms of water saving. Yeah, here, let me, yeah. So basically, when you take these two, best short-term practice, best long-term practice, put them together, it kind of leads into what we're gonna talk about, which is household gray water systems, and later on, just large-scale gray water systems in terms of connecting them together. And this is just kind of a diagram to get us familiarized with what gray water systems are. Essentially, when you look at the toilet or the sink or the washer, this is generally considered black water, and it's not really usable. You send this to wastewater plants. But gray water, such as stuff from like, you know, the sink or the shower or laundry machines, this can be sent back down and put into a gray water filtration system and then reused in the lawn or in the toilet. Because again, as he said, there's no reason to use potable water for certain things like the toilet. It's not essential. And sometimes even back into like the laundry machine. So this is actually a pretty good technique on a small scale. However, if you turn to the next slide, the immediate cost of gray water systems are kind of stifling. They're pretty heavy, especially the MSRP. Like, there's a huge initial investment. There's high installation costs. It takes a long time to construct and clean up. It's generally, like many renewable technologies, it's kind of having a rough start getting into the game. But as you can see here, the yearly maintenance fee is relatively low. And if you go to the next slide, you can see that there are ways to overcome the cost of gray water. Now, there's kind of a lot going on in this graph, but basically how I want to break it down off the bat is focus on these two different sections. There's individual and sharing. And basically the difference between these two is consider individual, like one house or two houses scattered across using gray water systems similar to this. Or you could do sharing, where consider like a cul-de-sac, where all the houses are using gray water, but there's one centralized gray water system, and they all kind of divert into that. And definitely, when you look at the two, it's clear that sharing is definitely a way to go on this. And the second thing that I wanted to point out, now that we're looking at just sharing, is there's two different types. There's membrane bioreactors, and then there's constructed wetlands. And as you can tell when it comes down to it, sharing and membrane bioreactors is definitely the best practice over the long term when it comes to kind of taking that cost for gray water. So achieving broad adoption of gray water systems, what really you need is incentives. We need to incentivize builders to install large gray water capacity systems. Again, going back to that sharing, and combine appropriate plumbing lines of other structures. And by doing this, you're allowed to kind of take advantage of using small-scale technology, take advantage of it on a larger scale, and up to 40% of indoor water can be recycled as gray water. And the more people that are utilizing this in a shared fashion, the more you can take advantage of stuff like that. So finally, achieving kind of a broad adoption of gray water systems, important to remember that there's this public fear in the minds of everybody right now that, you know, you can't mix potable water with treated gray water. It's something that just speaks to the base of human psyche that they don't really like that idea. But again, just like Clay said earlier in his speech, it's about education, public outreach, you know, talks like this kind of get the idea out there, get it kind of in the public mindset. Secondly, municipal governing, we need to refine the process of obtaining a permit to do this sort of stuff. Currently, it's really convoluted. It takes a long time. You have to jump through several hoops. And by easing this process, it would definitely encourage people to go after it. Because currently, it's kind of in the mindset of like, oh, you have to do so much. Why bother? It's not a necessity yet. And finally, plumbing code. It's kind of written like a traditional plumbing industry sort of thing. Like, you don't want to mix wastewater, your water supply with wastewater. You don't want them to share certain plumbing. But again, as new modalities come, as new innovations come within every sort of industry, you kind of have to change the way you're thinking. And this is definitely one of those things where it's going to have to be a thing eventually, especially in places like San Diego and Northern Baja. And that is the small scale as far as we wanted to speak about in terms of best practices. We think that gray water is definitely the way to go.
All right, very nice. And here's the research team that was behind this. A couple of these people had to go back to school already, but went on to acknowledge certainly Trevor, who couldn't be here tonight. He already had to head back to school. Chase is here. Chase is on camera tonight. And Anna, where are you? I know Gabriella. So Gabriella, she's been on the team. She's not presenting tonight. So, but all of these people have been involved in these projects collectively. You just saw the two people so far focused on the San Diego Northern Baja solutions. So that's what they recommend for our region, you know, large scale and small scale. There's some expensive solutions. There's some low cost solutions. There's rooftop for your solar. There's large wind, large solar. So any conversation with Derek and Clay to kind of summarize that roadmap. Clay, you want to come up here? Any questions for these guys, or are y'all good? Sai?
So for the household gray water systems, we need to use gray water compatible household products, right? Like laundry detergent and toothpaste or whatever.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
I think that makes it easy to purify the water. But what if we use the regular products, like by chance, like someone by mistake uses the regular laundry detergent, which is not gray water compatible, what happens then?
Yeah, it depends on the type of filter system that's being used. If you have a much more intensive filtration system, it could probably handle it. Again, that's not something you'd want to do multiple times. It's kind of like the question is like, oh, what if I wanted to, you know, do something like throw some like mud in the sink or something. It's just something generally you don't want to do even without gray water systems. And again, with any system, the filtration, eventually it's not going to be able to handle it, but it probably would be able to like stand it for a while, but it's something people would definitely have to be educated on not to do.
So the gray water system installers do that, right?
Educate yeah, them. Yeah, definitely. Okay. And again, it's not something that's commonplace right now, but it's definitely a technology that's improved immensely, and it's definitely able to handle that sort of thing.
I think I just saw one of the major builders in San Diego that was putting gray water systems next to all their brand new homes. So I think it added another, I want to say, somebody helped me out in the paper, it was another $1,500, $2,000 per house, but each individual house now had a recycling system built in. And I'd never seen that before. So pretty high end. I think it was Davidson or one of those builders. Anything else? You guys good? One more? Okay. Here.
Just a quick question. Did anybody look at or encounter in their research a name of John Todd?
I know John Todd, but they did not.
We've never run into that name.
I suggest you take a look at it. Just go online and run down what John Todd has to say about this whole subject.
Okay.
Interesting man who won the first Buckminster Fuller Challenge Award for successive water, what do you call them, water tub filtration methods that included hyacinths and tilapia and something like that. Is that right, Norm? Yeah. And at the end of these successive tubs, it was clean. You know, just natural processes ultimately will clean. And I think this had to do with water that came out of ash, you know, ash pits in Kentucky or something.
Basically what he says is that it's taken nature 3.9 million years to devise its own system of cleaning water, and that plants do the better job. And that research has been around since 1950, going back to Berlin and lots of different people have looked at it, and that system is continuing to evolve.
Very good. Would you give Derek and Clay a big hand? They did a great job. Yeah. Very nice, you guys. Okay, so we're going to shift now to a country level. Country level is we had some great Brazilian students here all summer long. And what you want to do on the laptops is you want to hit escape. If you lose the screen altogether, what you hit is you hit function F4. So for somebody who doesn't know that, maybe Derek, you could help, or you guys could help up here on, is it Lizzie? I forget your name.
Lizzy.
So that's how you'll get the screen up. And now you're looking for the presentation at the bottom that says Brazil. and that'll come up around the room. So these were students here all summer. They came from a program that the Brazilian government supports engineers that qualify to come to America and Europe. It's called the Brazilian Scientific Mobility Program. Science Without Borders, like I said. And they're supported by the government to be here and study at a university all year, and then they have to do a three-month internship program. We were lucky that they found us, and I think we've had six of these students all summer long. Four are still here. Two of them already had to go back to school. So it was terrific to have them here all summer. And so I can see that we have Anna, Leticia, and Renan are doing the presentations this evening. And this will be, how do you take a country, and a country right now that's in some cases looks a lot like California. There's places in Brazil that are in severe drought, just like us. There are places that just don't seem normal from our perception of Brazil, that are just like California and going through the same issues. They have enormous renewable potential like us. So it's interesting to look at this country and compare it to our country called California and see what we can learn from each other. And that's kind of what we've done here, is to look at Brazil's example and see how it might, not only how they could fix their water and energy system, but how it might apply to us as well. So I'll let them go ahead and fix this. It looks like it's up around the room except for a couple. And Anna, you're gonna begin? There you go. Anna, introduce yourself.
Hello. Hello, my name is Anna. I'm from Brazil. I study environment engineering, and I'm here in Jenny during the summer, and I spend much of my time here doing ArcGIS working about maps, and I also study about energy here. So, where's the pointer?
The pointer is right behind you.
Oh, here. Okay, so let's recap. This map is about the demographics in Brazil. This red dot is about the population, so the greater one is about the larger population. And also we have the population density here, so the darker colors, it's the places that there is a higher population density. So the most populated place in Brazil is the northeast region, and then the northeast. Now the population in Brazil is 204 million people, and in 2050 is going to be 226 people, million people. So most of the main source of energy supply, it's the hydropower plants. And wind energy is just 4.67, and solar is about 0.01. That is not significant. So the hydropower, it's not good for the environment. It could cause impact because most of them is in Amazon, and there are a lot of native people living here. And also it's about forest. So we have to diversify the source. And for this, we have four main sources, that is sustainable and renewable. It's wind, biomass, small hydros, and solar energy. So this is the solar energy potential. Brazil has a huge potential for solar energy, but we have just 11.2 megawatts of energy that is generated. And I did a method to analyze the solar potential in Brazil and to pick which are the best areas to put solar farms there. So in the first picture, it's all the potential in Brazil. That is that one, it's all the potential. The second step, it's about to remove the protected areas. And the third step, it's to extract the areas that are within 100 from the transmission lines. And in the last step, I extracted the areas that are within 100 kilometers from the cities that are greater than 100,000 people. So the best areas in this solar potential are the southeast and the northeast. But like all areas are good, also in Middle East and in North, there are some spots that are good according to this method. So for the wind energy, we have a good potential as well. We have around 140 gigawatts, and in Brazil, it generates about 130 gigawatts. So we can supply all Brazil with wind energy, but we produce just 6.45 gigawatts. And I did the same method for the wind, and the best areas are the southeast and the south and the northeast. So another thing that it's important to analyze when we are going to construct a power plant is to analyze the price of them. So here we have a table with the price. The second row is about the price to install, and the last row is about the price to operation that. So by analyzing this, we can see that the wind source and the biomass, it's not expensive if we compare to the hydropower plants and to the natural gas. Also in Brazil, we have some incentives for renewable energy. We have a program called ProInfa. The goal of this program is to diversify the source of energy in Brazil and also increase the security. And we already have two incentives. One is to do 50% of discount for the transmission of renewable source, and for solar, the discount is about 80%. We have another incentives from a bank called National Bank for Economic and Social Development. They have two kinds of program. The first one is Climate Fund program. Nowadays they are doing incentives just for solar energy, and they do this for companies, for the government, and residential and rural areas. And also there is another kind of program that they have, that they offer credit for renewable sources of energy. And the maximum that they can finance is about 80%, and could be just for legal entities and for Brazilian companies. In Brazil also, we can generate electricity in our homes, but they can have at maximum one megawatt, and could be all renewables like biomass, small hydro, solar, and wind. And there are two banks in Brazil that they offer loans for them. The loans is about 1.5 to 2.35%. So it's cheap, it's not expensive. And also they could have power generation in rural areas or in Amazon communities. In Brazil, we have a program called Light for All that they finance about 8.5% of the system. So the recommendations from Brazil, it's to diversify the energy matrix and to make larger power plants of wind, solar, and biomass. Because when they are larger, the average cost is going to be lower. And also increase the wind farms in Brazil, in the coast, in all the coast has a good potential, and increase the solar farms all around Brazil, in all areas, but we have to study more details. which areas has a good spot to do a solar farm, and to stabilize the hydro plants in Brazil and make more incentives and promote them.
Great. So that's the first set for Anna. Very nice job, Anna. Thank you very much. I'm going to acknowledge all of these and Anna first, because again, you're hearing people presenting not in their native language, right? And so still learning English and really doing quality work, and I think delivering in front of an American audience, that's a real challenge. So I want to acknowledge them. Questions for Anna on this first set of discussion around a major country plan to add renewables? Yes, Nick.
I would like to know what sort of percentage of the population at this point doesn't have access to electricity. And it might be interesting for you as a comparison that in the America in the 30s they had the rural electrification project. So I kind of suspect that it's similar to that. It will be the rural areas that don't have access to electricity, so I'm sure that the focus would be on that. But maybe you can say something about what percentage of the population doesn't have access to electricity at this point.
I don't know how many people has access to electricity, but the government are spending money on that. They have that program, Light for All. So people from rural areas or from Amazon rainforest could have access to energy, but I don't have numbers.
Anybody, you guys, any of your Brazilians know the percentage of access to electricity? Is it 80%, 90%? No? We can look it up. It's in the CIA World. It's in the CIA World Factbook. I know, because that percentage is in the factbook for every country. It's the most developed country of South America, but still has many people that are in extreme poverty. You know, kind of like just across, we had a lot of discussion that these students would go across the border into Tijuana this summer, and sometimes that felt like some of the favelas that they live in themselves, or in the cities that they live in. So they live in a first world city, but you go right across the border, right across the railroad tracks, and it felt like Tijuana felt like portions of Brazil. So this was an interesting relationship that we had with these students, because they were, you know, obviously well educated, you know, well trained in their universities, but having that same experience right next to us here at the border that we have here between San Diego and Baja. But I don't know that number exactly. Yeah. I know you skipped that graphic a little bit too soon. Could somebody, if you're on number three over there, Alex, could you go forward to number six? Just go to number six for me for a second, would you? Yeah, and let's let this one scroll. I do want to acknowledge Arno. Where is Arno back here in the back? So Arno Vede has been a very supportive volunteer here at Genie for, gosh, 4 or 5 months now. I'm not sure how long you've been here, but strong GIS skills and worked closely with Anna. And as you see these four maps kind of scroll through, there's really some very deep, thoughtful the information that you're getting out of that map. And so the first one is the solar potential, and you see that right there. Then they take away protected lands, what we would call lands that are national parks, lands that you wouldn't touch for whatever reason because they're protected. So you go from a technical potential to maybe an exploitable potential when you go into that terminology. So that's that second map, because you can't put solar farms everywhere. But then you'll see in that map that there's this huge potential of solar in Brazil, and I think you said it's only 0.01% so far.
Yeah.
Just nothing, right? No. Nothing has been developed. But the new president or the new government said we want to build a lot more. What's the capacity they want?
They are going to build 20 gigawatts.
20 gigawatts.
Yeah.
Of solar. So huge potential, and they're going to, and intention is there. But if you go to this next slide, then what they did is they added in transmission lines. So now if you're going to build large solar, you still got to put it on a transmission line, right? You got to, if it's over in the desert here in Southern California, you got to put it into a transmission line, the Sunrise Power Link, to get it to San Diego. Same thing there. So you want to build your best solar. So they picked those circles are your optimal solar locations, closest to the transmission line, closest to the load, because you want to minimize the distance. So that's what you can do with some of this GIS technology, is to start to put in parameters that make sense for a future developer, for a future planner, to say, where would you build your solar system optimally? And I really want to acknowledge Arno and Anna working on that. I don't think you gave it enough credence. This is really, really thoughtful work that took all summer to kind of build together. And then they did the same thing for the wind map. So very nice job for both of you. Thank you, Arno, for doing that. Yeah. So I kind of took some of your thunder there. Are you okay with that first set? Sai, you want to jump in with a question here?
Okay. I just want to know a little bit more about the biomass, how it's used to produce energy, because I personally am excited about that technology because it's carbon negative and it can produce biochar, which can be used in soil, and it's a climate mitigation technique. So yeah, just wanted some perspective on that biomass.
Okay, so most of the biomass comes from the sugar cane that we have a lot of production in Brazil. We have most of the production comes from the southeast, right? And from São Paulo State. And most of their energy comes from sugar cane. Renan knows more about that.
Hi, we use the sugarcane bagasse and we burn it and generate the heat to boil water. And this water vapor can spin a turbine and generate electricity. And it's in situ. So in our alcohol plant, we produce either alcohol and electricity, and we sell it to the grid.
So we're on to the next set. Can you start? We want 13 over here on number one. The numbers are bigger now, so that helps. So we should see 13 through 24 going all the way around the room. And Hinan, you're going to take these next two sets. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, good. So Hinan did a lot of work in the transportation sector and the biofuel sector a little bit as well, Sai. So introduce yourself, and we'll get started here.
Thank you. Okay. Good evening. I'd like to thank you all for coming to this presentation. I truly appreciate every presence here. My name is Renan. I am majoring in energy and fuels management back in Illinois, in Southern Illinois University, Carbondale. And I'm here to take my internship, to finish up my master's degree. And I mean, I'm close to be done. So, that's my first slide. There will be three slides about the last presentation that I have done here. That was where I discussed the major problems of our transportation sector in Brazil. And this is the first one. And the major problem, this problem is that we overly depend on road transportation for our freight transportation. So this is not good. Ideally, we should increase the use of waterways or railroads that are more efficient. So here in the 15, the slide number 15, we can see why the using the road transportation is a problem. Actually, 44% of the energy emissions comes from the road transportation. This chart shows up the historic evolution of our CO2 emissions. The purple one is deforestation, and the red one, the red part is energy. And 44% of the energy use is the transportation road. And we should diversify it. We should diversify our transportation mode. Because the other ways, waterway and the railroads, they are more friendly to the environment, as you can see in this statistic here from the World Economic Forum. From the logistics emissions, 70% goes to the from the all of the CO2 emissions of the logistic part. Road freight takes 57%, and the waterways and railroad just 76%. So it's much more good for the environment to use these two ways, and it's more energy efficient. If you consider the same energy input, trains and ships, they can go much farther. The distance are here in the chart. A truck can go 100 kilometers, railroad 300 and 370 for waterways. So here is the second major problem that I have stated in the last presentation. It's about investments, and Brazil is not doing that good. As you can see here, this is a couple of rankings, and even though we are in the top 10 ranking for economy, our infrastructure is way worse. We are like a third world. We are behind 100 countries in railroad, 120 in roads, and 130 in air transport infrastructure. So when you look at this chart, you should imagine we have to invest more and more in the infrastructure. And what we can see here is that we are doing the inverse way. We are investing less and less of our GDP in transport. This is the green column represented the fraction of our GDP that we use to our transportation system. So, moving on here, the third major problem of our transportation system is the traffic jams. We have huge traffic jams, and some solutions for the traffic jams are here in this image. They are obvious: bus rapid transit, light rail, more bike lanes, and subways. Subway here is the first and the major solution that I would say for my country. If you see here, this is Shanghai. It's in Portuguese, sorry, but this is Shanghai in China, and Rio is the second largest city. We have more than 1 million people passing each day in the urban system, and we have just one line in the subway. And in the same period of time, China has increased this amount. He has made this complex network for the subway, and Rio de Janeiro has done nothing. And we can see here that São Paulo, that is the major city in Brazil, has a good network and can serve as an example for the Rio de Janeiro, that is the second largest and my city in Brazil. So why should we invest in subways or metro? Because it's better for the environment. Here is the emissions for a common vehicle, a bus, and a metro, a subway. And in this comparison, it's clear that metro releases less CO2. And in the long term, it's going to be more cost-effective because it transports more people. So if you guys have any question, please.
All right, questions on this first set around the transportation, and I'm going to say some of the problems and mistakes that Brazil maybe is still making.
I'm wondering, but you might not have an answer for that, whether Brazil is investing less in rail infrastructure than the United States, but that's a side question, really. I was wondering, what is the real problem about the lack of use of rail in Brazil? Is it a lack of the size of the railway net? Do they need to build more railways? Or is it underutilized? Do they need to use it more, or is it perhaps a combination of both? There's not enough rail, and it's underused, what there is.
Thanks for the question. We are addicted to using the roads. We have railroads. We should just improve the quality of the system so we can connect them. But actually, we have a lack of will from the politicians to make that.
We have enough railroads.
Yes, we have either railroads and waterways. We have 50,000 of kilometers of waterways, but we only use 10,000. We could easily create more more ways from the water, from the rivers, and no.
It sounds like it's almost like being a lazy industrial country. It's like if you can put something on a truck, it's easier to do it on a truck than put it on a waterway or a railway. But clearly the efficiency or CO2 emissions would make the case for waterways and railways.
Yes.
In the United States, a lot more freight goes over the railways, I understand, than the road.
Gosh, I don't know that about railways and trucks in America. I know America runs on 18-wheel trucks. You know, there's so many semis on the roads every day. I don't know the answer to that.
My understanding that is the case, that a high percentage of goods does go by rail. It's just that it's much less used for passengers.
I did hear a statistic once about the United States that half of our rail traffic in the United States was used for moving coal from places like the Powder Basin of Wyoming, and it is moving coal from where we mine it to those coal-fired power plants in the Midwest.
This is why it's in such a bad shape, because coal trucks just beat the hell out of the tracks, the weight of it.
All right, good. I found it fascinating just to look at Rio de Janeiro compared to Shanghai. Look at what they do in Shanghai in two decades compared to Rio de Janeiro. There was no change whatsoever in their subway system. So I don't know if that speaks to Shanghai's, I don't know, wealth or desire to increase their economic capacity, but they certainly moved infrastructure quickly in their country, and Rio did nothing, right?
Yeah, that's the good solution for big cities, and Shanghai is the best one to exemplify that.
Yeah. Other questions, comments? Sai.
On the slide over there, the deforestation decreased in the last few years, right? So I was just curious if Brazil is doing something right to reduce the emissions from deforestation. Because I know a lot of deforestation is due to the livestock grazing, and that meat is, I think, shipped over here. So,
sorry, can you repeat the last part?
I think the deforestation is happening because for the livestock to graze, the cattle to graze, and they produce beef, which is like exported over here.
More than 60%.
Oh, okay. So what are they doing to reduce the deforestation? Because I see the reduction in emissions.
Actually, I don't know specifically what they are doing, but I see that they are doing something. In the last years, we reduced the CO2 emissions. It was equivalent to take all the cars out of all the cars from the US out of the US. Three times this amount. So it was our reduction of CO2 emissions by just reducing the deforestation.
Okay, good. So we got another set of slides here. We should be at 25 through 36 around the room. So I see they're already getting set up, so you can get started right away. Go ahead.
Okay. Rail number one, it's a comparison between light rail and bus, and the bus. Actually, I'm saying that light rail is another good example to implement in big cities like Rio de Janeiro and São Paulo. This is a comparison from the National Transit Database from the US, and it says that the light rail is 54% faster, 55% cheaper per mile, in terms of operation costs, 31% cheaper per passenger in terms of operation cost per passenger, and 74% better at the fare box. Jumping over the next slide, I want to say here that for small cities, maybe the use of bus rapid transit or rail, light rail, might not be a good solution because the costs decrease as long as the amount of people increase. I'm considering capacity here, okay? And here on number three, we can see two statements from United Nations about the light rail and metro subway. The United Nations say that they are costly to construct and maintain, but can provide significant long-term economic, social, and environmental benefits. And these benefits should be better if you better connect the intermodals, if you better connect the modes. Intermodal is like the railroad, buses, and the waterways. I mean, if you interconnect, if you have them close, where people can get to any point, from any point to any point, so you have a great system. Okay, now I'll change to the fuels that can improve the thing about climate change in Brazil. Here is our plant capacity for biodiesel production. And in the red column is our actual production that is pretty much driven by the blend mix, our blend mix requirement. That is 7% of biodiesel in any diesel, any mineral diesel. So we can see that here that 60% of our capacity is not being used. And if you just increase the blend mix, we would benefit the environment because we shouldn't increase this capacity. So we wouldn't create clean lands or deforest more to produce more biodiesel. We just would increase the production here. We have this room to improve. And here you can see that conventional fuels, it's canola oil and used oil, they can reduce the greenhouse gases amount up to 78.5%. And if you use next generation biofuels, we can reduce this amount up to 88%. And there's a lot of research going on, especially here in the US, on algae biodiesel. It's a very, very good source because you can use wastewater and you don't need that much land to produce biodiesel out of it. And you gotta be asking yourself, why this guy is not talking anything about solar cars and electric cars if it's the best thing here in San Diego? Because of the cost of the car in Brazil, it's 200,000 of reais. Here is a reality. If you buy a car here, you can have your payback period. You can have your payment back during your usage of the car because the fuel costs less than the fuel for a gasoline car. But in Brazil, it's the future. It's the future, but it's it's farther. It's not so close to us. And it's harder to make R$1 in Brazil than to make $1 here. So it's not only $58,000 equivalent in Brazil. It's 200,000 reais. It's a lot for us. Okay, so I'll pass the mic for my colleague. And
do that. So this is the completion of his transfer. He was focused on transportation. That was he came here to do research specifically on biofuels and transportation. So that's why he non-focused on that. So any conversation just specifically on their transportation sector, their biofuel sector, rail, light rail, any of that. Because he's making recommendations clearly for more rail, more metro. This is a tough one for Brazil because it costs a lot to do a electric car right now. But and I think you showed me one today where the only car company doing it is a Chinese company right now, right? All right, so Sai?
I wasn't clear from that slide. Is it biofuel plus regular gasoline blend, or they're using only biodiesel in the cars? And also, is it compatible like with the current cars? Can they run on biodiesel without any changes in the cars?
Biodiesel, it should have some modifications. But alcohol, we can use 100% alcohol. If you go to the pump, you can buy alcohol, hydrated alcohol. It's because our cars are flex fuels. Now, 70% of our fleet is flex fuel, and because the old cars are still there. All the new cars are flex fuels. And biodiesel, we are today up to, the law is 7% of blend mix, and the biodiesel market wants to increase it because they have room for that. It's clear. So I don't know if I answered your question.
Okay. So we good on the transportation side? You got another one. Okay, Zai. He's working in this sector, so he's real interested.
No, I'm not working in the sector. Okay. I like. Yeah. Regarding algae biodiesel, I saw on YouTube actually.
Here?
It's actually the CO2 emissions from the algae biodiesel.
Here?
Yeah. So I saw that for every barrel of biofuel produced, it sequesters 2 tons of carbon, but it only releases 1 ton of carbon. So the net effect is it's a carbon negative thing. So for every barrel of biofuel produced, algae biodiesel produced, it captures. Algae is nothing but photosynthesis, right? So it captures CO2 from the atmosphere. So it captures 2 tons of CO2. But when you burn it only releases 1 ton of CO2.
Where's the other ton go?
I don't know. That's what I saw. So
that's a good thing.
So maybe you want to look into that.
It's got to be in the biomass remainder, right? It's still... So the part that's not oil, that carbon is in that part that... It probably goes into a landfill or into pig feed or something of that sort. I don't know. Could go back into the soil. I don't know. But that's I think anything that's biological that captures carbon ultimately is going to release it. But the idea is you want to use that cycle as opposed to extracting fossil fuel out of the ground, which has been sequestered for millions of years, right? Paul Michael.
Hi, Paul.
Hi. In terms of I'll call it fully electric vehicles, they're even more out of reach than for biofuels. Is that correct?
Sorry, can you?
The all-electric vehicles, the ones run or charged or recharged through solar photovoltaics, are they more out of reach than the biofuels?
Out of reach?
More expensive? More costly? Are they more costly in Brazil?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. And the other question was, just to be clear, the hydrogen cars, the all-hydrogen cars, are they more costly as well? Or has there been no conversation about that at all to compare them to biofuels?
The hydrogen?
Hydrogen.
Yeah, they are more expensive.
Even more expensive. Great, yeah. That's all.
Okay, great. Would you give Hinan a break hand? Thank you very much. Very good.
Thank you.
And so for our last, Leticia, come on up here. So pass the mic along to Leticia here. So she's going to jump into the water issue. That's been her focus while she's been here in San Diego. So Leticia has the last set. There'll be 6 and one more set after this. Please introduce yourself and thank you.
So good evening. I'm Leticia Carvalho. I'm also an environmental student at Federal University of Lavras back in Brazil. Tonight, I'm going to present a roadmap based on a GeoDesign solutions of clean water for all in Brazil. At first, I'd like to do a quick recap using some maps of my previous presentation, section 3. And here, in the left-hand side, I have the geographic condition in Brazil of the water availability and the water stress. Here you can see the natural semi-arid location region in Brazil. And these red spots also represent the most populated urban centers, that is in São Paulo and Rio, and also Minas Gerais. At the same time, here you can see the water availability by volume, in volume by basin. So then you can see that these both things match, the red darker located in the northeast and through the southeast of Brazil. So combining that with the current situation of the drought, we can see that Brazil has currently been a bitter example that water availability does not mean water accessibility. So what we can do to solve that? At first, I'll focus on the northeast region that is that suffers with a chronic drought. And one of the solutions that I brought here is being processed now. That is the San Francisco River transposition that takes the water from the San Francisco River, divided with two axes, the north and east, and it brings water to the inner area of the northeast region here. And they are also constructing small reservoirs and dams that will keep this water and then supplies this rural area. Some of the benefits that I can show you is, besides to supply the water for this population, is also real rinse incomes and trading of this affected region, since this water is intended to be used for small agricultural sectors, and also supply a lot of the poor population, and at the same time reduce illness and deaths caused by the contaminated water that they usually have access there. So some of you may think that river transposition does not seem a good solution, since it can affect the natural environment. So for you guys, I have this another option for the northeast region that is being researched for by some of the students in one of universities in Ceará. And this is a different kind of desalination plant called Windy Energy Converter Powered Reverse Osmosis that uses the wind to generate the energy necessary to push the water through the water membrane and then gets the clean water to supply this area. The good point of that is not like just the technology, is that it really matches this region. As you can see here in this graph, the water flow through the year and also the windy occurrence on the land and also the coast. I pick here an example of the month of August with the lowest water availability. It's at the same time the moment of the peak of windy occurrence. This would provide electricity through the year and also clean water during the most dry seasons.
Very nice. So that's just a first introduction. There's 12 more, the 12 last slides for the series. Any questions, conversation about this first set here? So it's looking at Brazil actually has dry areas. You know, I didn't even know that until these students came and really explained it. So that northeast part of Brazil is typically dry like our region, and so they're looking for solutions themselves to either desalinate or literally redirect river systems so that they can meet the needs of people who are underserved. Expensive, right? Expensive to drill drill holes and caves through mountains and to lift water. But once you get it over the hill, like we do in LA, it flows downhill, and that's the idea to serve that population. And a nice marrying of wind power to lack of rain. So that's a nice concept there that they developed. Okay, so let's do our last set here. So the numbers, is that right? Are we going to start with 37? Case 37, 38, 37 all the way through 48 around the room. And this will be the completion here for the series. Leticia, go ahead.
So besides these two options that I showed here as in large scale for all the country, I also brought some smaller scale solutions for the scarcity of water. Here in the slide 37, we have the residential water capture that caps the rainwater through the gutter that passes through a filter and then can be storaged and use it for cleaning, washing machines, gardening, and also restored for a period of time during rainy seasons. This also can be applied in a slightly bigger scale as a university. This is an example of my university back in Brazil that was considering the last year, the 2060 Greener University through the Green Metric World University ranking as a sustainable university. And it's also the first one of the Latin America. And the main reason of that is the rainwater use that we have that collects the water from all the lecture halls, also the restaurant and the library that goes into this reservoir and supplies almost all the daily water used inside the campus. And it also has a plan to increase that by the construction of two or maybe three more reservoirs. So after the solutions that make different constructions, I'd ask why not prevent the water waste instead of try to change it of place or just building new technologies. Brazil, the reason is that Brazil is one of the countries with higher clean water waste in the world. And in the urban centers, the main reason of that is the leakage. So for that, I brought here one example that is being applied in the San Diego County. That's the replacement and fixing the old pipes. The two options that we have is the replacement of cast iron pipes to PVC or HDP pipes that are more efficient, or in an easier way is to rehabilitate that, putting lining that with hard plastic, taking all the old crystallization that we can see here. Another option that is really important to Brazil is the change of the irrigation method mostly used there. As I told in my previous presentation, most of the water in Brazil goes directly to the agriculture sector. And in 2 years ago, we can see that almost half of that was lost just to do it to wasteful practices. The reason is that the mainly irrigation method in Brazil is the flood irrigation, that's part of the surface irrigation here. And my advice would be to change it for drip irrigation that has as benefit a higher production, less water used, and it can also be seen this reality just thinking about Israel that has a really low water accessibility and a really successful production. This map also shows that the drip irrigation system has 90 to 95% of efficient, while the flood irrigation most used in Brazil reaches just 40 to 60%. However, this is a global situation where you can see that just 85% of the irrigated area is that all of that using these two methods, while less 5% of the irrigated areas in through the world using this drip irrigation method.
Very good. Any questions? That's a summary. Very nice. So let me ask Anna to come up, Hinan to come up, Clay to come up, Derek to come up. You stay behind the camera for just a second there, would you, Gabriella? And who else is here? Who else is here? Clay, would you? I'm sorry, Chase, would you come on up here as well? Yeah, I know. I did that before, didn't I? So while we have a chance, these are the remaining students that are here for the summer. There's about five of them that already had to go back to school. But this was, they didn't know each other before they came. I promise you, they know each other extremely well after being here all summer. They're all Facebook friends. They've all been going out and have fun in our gas lamp and going to San Francisco and Vegas and places. It's been terrific to work with all of them. Thank you all very much. Would you give them a big hand? Hey, not a lot of people here tonight, but not a lot of people will see this. I really want to acknowledge you guys. You did a great job. Yeah. Did you learn a lot? Yeah. Learned a lot, didn't you? Yeah. It was a great summer course. So any more questions for these guys before we close? You guys, any more? Ray, you good? These were their recommendations. This was their roadmap for San Diego, for Northern Baja, for Brazil. They were actually giving us recommendations on day two when they came in here. But we said, hang on a little bit. You need to do a little bit deeper investigation. So this was their best of their best tonight, and I really want to acknowledge you all. You want to say some more? Yeah.
I want to thank you also for the opportunity for receiving me here. And I want to say to everybody here that is a very good teacher, very patient with us, and I mean, just thank you for everything we have done. You have done for us. Yeah. I put Ron's name there. You see, what? Okay, Peter, Ron, and Jeannie,
and Paul Michael.
Michael
Russell back here.
Sure.
Right. you wouldn't look good on video if it wasn't for Peggy and Ron and Michael back there.
Yeah, and Arnaud back there. Awesome. Helped us a lot.
So, you want to thank everybody again for their support. Ron certainly stepped in while I was on vacation the last 2 weeks.
Michael and Pagan make us look good on video and spread this out around the world, so it's not just the few of us that are here, but clearly this can be seen anywhere in just a few minutes. They post this on our YouTube channel, and it's seen anybody who wants to see, so Mom and Dad can see it back home. That's always nice, right? Or when you're applying for a job, you can post this and you can say, let me show you what I did on my summer vacation in 2015. So it's a great summer. These guys did great work. We will do this again next month. We get back into our regular programming with our movie nights, our green scene evening, with also our program with the San Diego Renewable Energy Society. We want you all to come back for that. We'd like to all have you join and become members of the Sim Center. It's a simple thing to do on a white card or online. It's relatively inexpensive, and you get to come for free. So that's the good thing. Come to all our programs for free after that. Thank you, guys. It's great to be with you here all summer. I know some of you leaving tonight or tomorrow. Oh, Leticia will miss you already. The rest of them here have to kind of complete the summary of this and write up the summary and make sure there's a video element of this next week, so they have another few days next week. Thank you all for being here. Great summer.